everybody out here tonight. Say yeah.
I promise the funk, promise to keep his promise, you'll keep the funk. I promise the funk, promise to keep his promise, you'll keep the funk.
Needless to say. Needless to say, he's been an influence on me and everyone I know. That's all we talk about, that's all we groove on. Sitting down with him, he said to me, everybody's got a little light under the sun. I mean, that's really where his music is. You got to really get into it and dig it. So with great pleasure, I want to say, George, I love you and I need you. And I'm happy to be here to induct you into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
I'd like to thank Prince, who's my main man backstage.
Prince made us all a better musician. Spiritually is the most important thing, because he was a very spiritual man. But as a musician, he pushed us. He made us better. And so we miss him deeply.
Thank you guys very much. Thank you for being here. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Telling me, have you heard?
Cincinnati native Bootsy Collins knew Prince better than most. In the late 70s, both joined Warner Brothers around the same time.
Prince come in like, you know, like gangbusters, and you know, all over and crossing all barriers.
Learning from each other, Bootsy says there was something about him so unique.
He mixed the music and the business together, and he didn't have which one was better or which one was worse.
I don't know, I guess most of them want to know how is it working with Prince. Uh-huh. And it's very good. I mean, Prince is a funketeer. He's been funking a long time, hang around. We've been hanging around a long time, and we just did a movie thing together.
Oh, really?
Graffiti Bridge, and that's working pretty good. As a matter of fact, on my way over here, I was doing 4 songs with him, two with him, and 2 with this rapper that he's got in this movie, Graffiti Bridge. So,
a new rapper.
Yeah, new rapper,
I think his music is always gonna be in the DNA. I mean, it ain't going nowhere. I mean, it's there.
Let me just say something about George, since he's a good friend of mine. One time he sent me a tape and says, you pee on it and then send it back to me. And I'll pee on it and then we'll see what we got. So. This is what George is all about to me and mine.
You worked with him, you were on his record label. What's going through your mind tonight?
Well, the world is going to be missing a great personality, not only a performer, but songwriter. And with me, a good friend. You know, just watching, we used to call him the kid. Myself and Mavis Staple over there in Paisley Park. I haven't processed it yet. I'm still like in denial.
The great George Clinton is the father of this funk mothership, a soulful supergroup that included legends like Bootsy Collins, Bernie Worrell, Eddie Hazel, and all the other brilliant musicians and singers that have signed on for duty.
Well, he did induct us into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and that to me was, you know, it don't too much get no better than that, other than Michael Jackson. But Michael Jackson was there too, so we got I guess the best of both worlds, right? Mm-hmm. You know,
Prince speaks highly of you. What is it like being around him?
quiet. No, Prince is so bad. Prince is so bad. You know, that he expects everybody else to be bad like him. So when you do something real bad, he'd be like, yeah, thanks. That's what you're supposed to be. Yeah. And he's cool people. I mean, he's cool people. His style is just quiet. He do his job, he expects you to do yours. He's real quiet. I mean, I think I get probably more out of him than anybody, you know, a little respect, but I joke with him a lot.
Yeah.
You know, like, what's your name? You said a year ago your name was Prince and you was Funky. Now you done changed it to a sign. I don't know what's up. So yeah. I haven't seen him since he changed the name. So you got to tell me what's his new name. I call him Morphidate. I think somebody know what it is.
Yeah. But you're friends of Prince. Oh, so you can
say my that. Man. I mean, I talk about his high heels on him. Yeah. It's cool. It's my boy.
Yeah, that's another thing about your music.
I'm on his label. He'll fire me if I don't.
Yeah, it's Paisley Park, right?
Right.
Yeah.
I would go over his house after the show and just sit around and kick it. You know, political or social or any of that. He was very interesting, but like you said, he was mysterious. But it was mainly for to preserve his own energy.
That's great. George, I'm sorry we're talking under these circumstances, but it's a real pleasure to talk to you, and I'm a big fan, so thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
I went to see him at the Beverly Theater, and it was frightening. 14 people singing knee-deep in unison. That night, I went to the studio and recorded Erotic City.
Put your hands together. In the name of the purple one.
Yeah. All of my life. relationship or your experience with him, what are some of the things that stand out in your mind, not only him as a musician, but just as a friend?
Yeah, well, I mean, this cat was like back in 19, I was at Warner Brothers in 1976, and he came in Warner Brothers in 1978. So unbeknownst to me or anybody how incredible this young man was gonna be, you know, it was like, we were like filling our oats, like, you know, we were like, you know, we were doing it at that time. So, you know, it was like, you know, he would come to the shows, and I know we'll forget this, the Funk Fest we did out in L.A. We had over 100,000 people. Now, remember, we're not playing to crossover artists, you know, audiences. We're just playing to mainly us, you know. Over 100,000 people. I mean, you know, and this was not just in L.A. This was pretty much all the stadiums that we would do. And so that's the era that we was coming up in. But Prince come in like, you know, like gangbusters, and, you know, all over and crossing all barriers, you know. And it was like, wow, that's when we really start paying attention. This cat knows, you know, he knows what he's actually doing. You know, we was just acting a fool. I mean, you know, we was doing what we love. We love to play, you know, we love to have parties, you know, and all of that. But this cat had a plan. And that's what I really admired about him. You know, he mixed the music and the business together, and he didn't have which one was better or which one was worse, you know. For me, it was always the business was a curse and music was the blessing. So I don't think he looked at it like that. It was more of, you have to deal with both of them. And I think that's what I learned from him. You know, he learned a lot of little stuff from me, but, you know, we learn a lot of stuff from pretty much everybody. You just kind of gotta be out there in that, you know. And
even on my way here, I was listening to the radio and they were playing a lot of songs that were inspired by Prince. And so, like, yeah, looking forward, I think on Twitter I saw, you know, musical greats like Michael Jackson, Whitney Houston.
Yeah.
A lot of people, yeah, who influence, like, how do you, you know, two generations from now, how do you think that's going to change music for, like, you know, future?
You mean Prince music?
In general. Just, yeah, people having his influence. I guess his musical influence.
I think his music is always going to be in the DNA. I mean, it ain't going nowhere. I mean, it's there. You know, it's like you can't change what happened in the, you know, the history. It's in there. Mm-hmm. And his music is there. I mean, so anybody that does anything, you're probably going to hear a little Prince in it. You know, so, you know, it's in there. It's just like funk. You know, the purest form of funk. It's in there, whatever it is, whatever style it is, you know. So
I have to ask, it may be a hard choice. Now, what would you say is your favorite Prince song?
Just yeah, I was just going over that. For me, you know, he did so many incredible songs, but the one for me, because I know what he kind of know what he was going through, was the controversy. And it was so many different issues going on at that time when he did that song that was personal to him, that I feel like that song was close to him, very close, you know, because what does he talk about? He's talking about all those different controversies that mm-hmm. goes on and, mm-hmm. you know, and it wasn't just happening to him, it was just life in general that happens. And what's deep about it is today you even see it more, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like real now. Then it wasn't real. It was just, yeah, he just, you know, he's just a freak, you know. But now it's the norm, you know. So he knew something, you
is
know.
Is there anything else that you wanted to add or?